Hello, my name is Marc Valdez, and today I'm speaking on the influence of surrealist artist Salvador Dalí on the television shows Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul, particularly in regard to how his works influence filming location choices. Some quick facts regarding Salvador Dalí. He was a prolific artist known best for his many dreamlike surrealist paintings. Dalí yearned to capture the nuclear revolution of the 20th century in works of art. Politically, he was difficult to characterize, both an anarchist and a monarchist. After World War II, he was an international celebrity, perhaps the second most famous artist in the world, eclipsed only by Pablo Picasso. Salvador Dalí and Vince Gilligan alike share a background of traditional Catholicism and enthusiasm for science. Dalí provides visual models for the television shows. Sometimes the models are prosaic. For example, Dalí did set design for a ballet featuring numerous sacks of grain that look very much like the sacks at the industrial laundry in Breaking Bad. Here on the left is the truck, which may be the model for the scene where the cousins purchase bulletproof vests. Dalí enjoys providing unusual points of view. For example, this view of the crucifix as seen from above in Christ of St. John of the Cross. It's very much like our view of Chuck during his hospital visit in Better Call Saul, after he had fallen and hit his head. Here we have a view of Dalí's Corpus Hypercubus, featuring Christ on a hypercube cross. A hypercube cross is an unfolded tesseract, a four-dimensional cube unfolded into three dimensions. When we see Jimmy's nail salon office from above in the episode Uno, there's a metal grid in the foreground of the scene that calls to mind the composition of the hypercube cross painting. An image of the hypercube cross appears together with a traditional Spanish mission cross in a mural in the background of the episode Chicanery when Jimmy is cross-examining Chuck. In 1859, Jean-François Millet painted this painting, The Angelus. The Angelus is a prayer said at the end of the workday, here by these two potato farmers. This painting was among the most famous paintings in France in the 19th century and an object of patriotic pride. To Dalí, however, everything about this painting was suspicious or enigmatic, and he became obsessed with it. Dalí used the Angelus in a number of his own paintings, including this one, an archaeological reminiscence of Millet's Angelus. There are images in Breaking Bad that make one pause. For example, this one of Skyler at the car wash. On the left, we have Skyler with her head bowed, and on the right, inanimate objects like a broom, a duster, and a squeegee. This image may be inspired by an archaeological reminiscence of Millet's Angelus. And I particularly like how set design and bold lighting facilitate the use of Dalí's The Last Supper in Breaking Bad. Christ gestures with his right hand very much like Gale does in the Super Lab. The various disciples have their heads bowed like Walt does while looking at the chessboard. But Dalí provides more than just visual models. He also provides ideas that the shows elaborate upon. For example, in the episode Felina, Walt leaves his watch on a gas pump. I think the show creators have him do this as an homage to Salvador Dalí and his melting clocks. Dalí did this work, Disembodied Telephone in the Desert. Better Call Saul has a disembodied telephone in the desert too, at the end of which you find Saul Goodman. Dalí had a rocky relationship with his father. In response, Dalí adopted various father figures in his life. For a number of years, Sigmund Freud was his father figure. Then Dalí became excited by the physics revolution of the 20th century. He dropped Freud and adopted Werner Heisenberg, known best for the uncertainty principle, as his father figure. It's through Dalí that Heisenberg enters Breaking Bad, and not directly through the world of science. In the pilot episode, Walt takes his life savings and hands them to Jesse in order to buy an RV. Jesse asks him, "Why are you doing this?" Walt responds cryptically, "I am awake." What does he mean? Is Walt encouraged by the business possibilities of making meth, or is Walt just as egocentric as Salvador Dalí? "Each morning when I awake, I experience again a supreme pleasure, that of being Salvador Dalí." Dalí was the first to explore a connection between bacon and the passage of time. On the left here, we have his soft self-portrait with fried bacon. We have a strip of bacon down here at the bottom. This is Dalí's face with crutches holding up the sagging jowls and eyelids as his face ages. In Breaking Bad, of course, bacon was used to mark birthdays. Dalí uses a lot of crutches in his work, holding up things that couldn't support themselves otherwise. The creative team at Breaking Bad, I'm sure, wanted to follow Dalí and use a lot of crutches too. But the only way you can reliably do that is to have a regularly appearing character who needs to use crutches. And hence we have Walter Jr., aka Flynn, who needs to use crutches. And here's another painting by Dalí, Saint Sebastian, with his crutches. Breaking Bad's golden moth ultimately comes from Salvador Dalí. In 1929, he worked with Luis Buñuel to create a silent film called Un Chien Andalou. It was the first film to feature the ominous Death's Head hawk moth. The hawk moth has a feature on its back that looks like a skull. That skull feature was abstracted away for the golden moth in Breaking Bad. The hawk moth has proven popular among filmmakers. It appears, for example, in promotional materials for the film The Silence of the Lambs. There are many poisons in the world, but Breaking Bad chooses to use Lily of the Valley. Why that poison? As it turns out, Lily of the Valley is a popular ingredient in perfumes. Salvador Dalí went into the business of making perfumes twice in his life, in the 1940s and again in the 1980s. Today you can order Salvador Dalí perfumes on the web, and about a third of them contain Lily of the Valley. I think it's because Lily of the Valley would have been important to Salvador Dalí that Breaking Bad chooses to use it for the poison in the TV show. Here's a painting on the left that's called The Royal Tiger, for short. You can see the eyes of the tiger. Hank sings Survivor's song, Eye of the Tiger, to Walt, as he imagines bringing Gus to justice. But the only tigers that Hank ever meets is this girl's athletic team. We see the eyes of a tiger, one of the principal players of the team, as Hank learns that his witnesses in custody have all been executed. Among Dalí's most important personal legacies is his theater museum in Figueres, Spain, finished in 1974. The museum was built on the site of a theater that was burned down in the Spanish Civil War. It has a horseshoe-shaped courtyard around which we find a number of niches arrayed in a semicircle, very much like bay windows, each one of which is occupied by a mannequin. These niches were the box seats of the original theater. We also see here on the left a tower of tires. And in the center, we have an automobile with a mannequin inside. You can sit in the passenger seat, insert a coin into a slot, and get hit by a blast of water. The automobile is called Rainy Taxi. In the episode 50% Off in Better Call Saul, Jimmy takes Kim to a modern home for sale. We see the living room with beautiful white walls and a variety of niches. We see also on both the first and second floors, bay windows. And Kim surprises Jimmy with a blast of water. All these features echo the theater museum in Figueres, Spain. Among Dalí's most famous paintings are, here on the left, The Persistence of Memory from 1931, and on the right, The Disintegration of the Persistence of Memory from 1954. I like to think Breaking Bad represents the first painting and Better Call Saul represents the second. In the first painting, we see a beach landscape. A melting clock sits on a platform and a fly sits on the clock. We have a pocket watch on the platform that's swarmed by ants, signifying decay. We have a bare olive tree with another melted clock draped on it. In the distance, we have the headland of Cadaqués, a familiar landscape feature located near where Dalí lived. And this slug-like feature representing Dalí himself. In the painting on the right, we see the same scene, but the insects are gone. Everything is being stripped down to its basics. The platform is a grid of bricks, as is the beach, and the bricks are flying off as conical warheads that proceed to harass the various clocks. Everything is disintegrating. The olive tree is in pieces, and the ocean surface is hung up here on a tree on the left. The headland is floating just above the ocean surface, and we have a mysterious fish that just appears. Like the painting, after Chuck's death, Jimmy's moral universe begins to fragment and disintegrate. We see a lot of grids, triangles, and cones in season 5, and I think we'll see a lot more in season 6 of Better Call Saul. For example, here we have Jimmy's ice cream cone mobbed by ants. At Tio's birthday party, everyone is wearing cones on their heads. At Louis' bar, we have a lot of conical-shaped lamps above the pool tables. These lamps had been seen in Breaking Bad, but very much in the background. In Better Call Saul, they are very much in the foreground. At the Tweaker party, we have a stolen gnome with a conical-shaped head and a triangular-shaped break that covers half the face. The most notable triangles that appear in Dalí's works are obelisks. In his painting, The Temptation of Saint Anthony, we see Saint Anthony here on the left, warding off a whole variety of temptations that come in on spindly-legged elephants, including an obelisk on an elephant's back, an idea which comes from Bernini's 1667 statue. The obelisk represents divine wisdom, but Egyptian, not Christian. And so, having learned a little bit about Salvador Dalí, I wanted to use that knowledge to solve several mysteries about Breaking Bad that had bothered me over the years, particularly those that shed light on why certain filming locations were chosen for the show. The first mystery is, why was the interior space of the airport parking structure chosen as a filming location? The second level stairwell there was the place where Walt calls Jesse and tries to convince him to cook. Jesse replies that he has plans, and Walt says, smoking marijuana, eating Cheetos, and masturbating do not constitute plans in my book. The word masturbating is a red flag for Salvador Dalí's influence, given the number of works Dalí painted on the subject. The glass roof light of this space isn't shown on TV, suggesting that modern architecture isn't of concern. This location has an unusual point of view for Breaking Bad, neither at ground level nor elevated, but somewhere in the middle, making one think that the creative team was trying to mimic a specific view somewhere. But what view? Does Salvador Dalí have a view that works? Actually, Dalí does. Two of them, Palladio's Corridor of Thalia and Palladio's Corridor of Dramatic Disguise. A mid-level point of view is chosen for both paintings. At the end of the corridor in both paintings, we have a girl in a bell skirt, a jumping rope. And more about her in a little bit. And who was Palladio? Andrea Palladio designed the Teatro Olimpico in Vicenza, Italy in 1580. Palladio died before the theater was completed, so the stage set behind the proscenium was designed by Vincenzo Scamozzi. And so my working hypothesis is that the interior space of the airport parking structure in the episode 4 Days Out was chosen as a filming location because it is the closest approximation one could find in Albuquerque to the trompe-l'oeil stage set of Teatro Olimpico. In the episode No Moss, the first episode of season 3, Walt feels remorse for his plane crash victims and starts to burn his money in the backyard barbecue. He changes his mind, though, and throws himself and the barbecue into the pool. He then fishes out the money with a skimmer pole. All of this seems reasonable. Why then, in the next episode, does Walt, apropos of nothing, use a skimmer pole to fetch a Band-Aid from his apartment complex's swimming pool? The Band-Aid is virtually invisible to a passerby. What does this mean? Is this still remorse at work? Apparently, yes, but it's remorse of a never-ending kind. The long skimmer pole is analogous to the grotesquely large hand in this Dalí painting. Walt felt remorse about killing people, just like Dalí felt remorse about masturbation. But just like Dalí, Walt would never, ever stop. The big hand returns in the episode Fly with Walt's makeshift fly swatter. Walt's delights of remorse are expressed with neurotic perfectionism, as if fewer people will get killed if things are just done better. The third mystery is, why is there a small fake tree in the background of the desert scene that starts the episode Say My Name? If you go to the actual location, you won't find the tree. It was a prop. It's supposed to be a juniper tree, but it is very unusual looking for a juniper. Most juniper trees are round or perhaps have a tapered shape, but this tree is too small and top heavy and leans over to the side. Here, the tree's image is closely associated with that of Mike Ehrmantraut. Then, later in the same episode, when Mike is disposing his guns down a well, we see a second leaning tree, a tall cottonwood in the distance. Once again, the tree is closely associated with Mike Ehrmantraut. And then I remembered that Dalí has a painting, The Three Sphinxes of Bikini. In 1946, the United States detonated 3 atomic bombs at Bikini Atoll in the Pacific. Subsequently, there were more, but in 1947, there had been 3. I think these 2 trees I mentioned are symbolic mushroom clouds, foreshadowing Mike's death at the end of the episode. In the episode Madrigal, Mike had told Walt that he was a ticking time bomb and that he didn't want to be around for the boom. So what boom was Mike talking about? He was talking about these booms, these figurative nuclear detonations. And so if we have 3 mushroom clouds and just 2 trees, there must be a 3rd tree somewhere. And sure enough, towards the end of the episode, we have this tall cottonwood that also leans over to the side. But the scene takes place in a grove of trees, so Mike's death is a figurative nuclear holocaust. I also wanted to learn a little bit more about the girl who finds Walt's gas mask at the end of episode 2 of Breaking Bad, the cat's in the bag. Just who is she in a symbolic sense? The Cat's in the Bag was filmed in 2007, but the roots of the story start off more than 70 years before, when Dalí was experimenting with the similarity in shapes between a feminine-shaped bell in a belfry and a girl in a bell skirt jumping rope. In both cases, we have a hoop over the head. Here, the hoop over the bell in the belfry, and also the jump rope over the girl. The theme continued in landscape with girls skipping rope. Here she skips rope, and there's a belfry in the distance. This is a view, as Dalí recalls it, looking out his schoolroom window when he was a kid. At the left, we have a church with a feminine-shaped bell, and on the right, we have a girl jumping rope. And here we have closer views. In 1947, Dalí worked on a joint project with Walt Disney on an animation short called Destino. The project was shelved, but it was ultimately completed in 2003. Dalí goes in a slightly different direction from the girl skipping rope. Here we have a young woman wandering across an empty Dalinian landscape. She sees an obelisk with a figure frozen in it, a figure representing time. She also sees the shadow of a bell tower and a bell. The bell's shadow is symbolic of the purity within herself, and she clothes herself in the shadow. Then a transformation occurs. The young woman is now wearing the bell skirt. She has a hoop over her head, but instead of a jump rope, it is her own hair. And the figure in the obelisk comes to life as she dances with joy and love. In 1969, Dalí did a number of illustrations for Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland. He returns to his original approach of the girl jumping rope. Here on the left, we see the white rabbit, and we see Alice with her jump rope jumping on top of a mushroom. We also see a walking stick. A walking stick was presented in Breaking Bad in the episode Breakage. Similarly, here on the right, a caterpillar was presented in the episode Grilled. The creative team at Breaking Bad wanted to explore some of these Alice in Wonderland concepts for the girl who finds Walt's gas mask. They would originally have wanted to bring the girl into the scene in a bell skirt jumping rope, but there are important practical considerations. One, it's impossible to jump rope wearing a bell skirt. Two, it's impossible to travel quickly while jumping rope. And so they compromise and introduce the girl running playfully along as her playmate kicks a ball. The creative team needs to identify her as Alice in Wonderland, and the way they do that is by dressing her in a denim jumper. She is Alice in Wonderland. She is the one who jumps. As she enters the scene, music from Glenn Phillips' The Hole is playing, The Rabbit Hole. She finds Walt's gas mask, which he had discarded in a fit of frustration, and puts it on. This gas mask is unique in the television series. It has a face shield that bows outwards, and so when we have a point of view from below the girl's face and she looks upwards, we see the arch over her head formed by the face shield. She holds her arms straight down her sides, but her hands flare out. She is in the process of transforming into a bell, but unlike the young woman in Destino, this is not a happy transformation. The woman in Destino had leapt for joy and had done a dance. Here, putting on the mask takes the play out of Alice and paralyzes her. Instead of joy, the experience is like a loss of innocence. And so I would like to show you the transformation sequence from Destino. We'll be as one for we know. Oh. I urge everyone to watch Destino, which is available on YouTube. Among its delights are images of the heads of Walt Disney and Salvador Dalí on the backs of turtles, which may have inspired the Tortuga scenes in Breaking Bad. And here is the transformation sequence in Breaking Bad. And so that is my presentation. Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul use Salvador Dalí's works for inspiration, visual models, and ideas. And as a consequence, the better you understand Salvador Dalí and his works, the better you'll understand Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul. Dalí's extravagant style and creativity make him a perfect guiding spirit for Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul. Thank you for your attention.